God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Yes, indeed, to God be the glory for the things he has done. Come on, let's get into the word of the Lord and study it for ourselves. I thank God for this opportunity to come to to come together with you again as we fellowship once again in the name of the Lord and we get deeper and deeper into his word and into his scriptures. Let's go into the new book, Acts. Let's go into the book of Acts right now. And let's go into book Acts, the 12th chapter. And we're going to go to the 20th verse. So we're going to Acts chapter 12, the 20th verse. You must have your Bible because I've been saying in the book of Acts for so long. In the book of Acts. In the book of Acts. So I know you have the book of Acts. It follows, of course, the book of John. And John is preceded by Mark, Luke, and Matthew. Okay? So we're now in Acts chapter 12. Beginning at verse 18, Acts chapter 12, and these are the Acts of the Apostles, Acts chapter 12, beginning at verse 18. Now as soon as it was day, there was a small stir among the soldiers. What was become of Peter? Okay, what was become of Peter? And when Herod had sought for him and found him not, he examined the keepers and commanded that they should be put to death. And he went down to Judea of Caesarea and there abode. And Herod was highly displeased with them in Tyre and Sidon. But they came with one accord to him, and having made Butes, the king's chamberlain, their friend, desired peace, because their country was nourished by the king's country. And upon a set day, 21, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne, and made an oration unto them. He made a speech to them. And the people gave a shout, saying, "It is the voice of a God and not of a man." And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him because he gave not God the glory. And he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. My Lord. 24, but the word of the Lord grew and multiplied, and Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry and took with them John, whose surname was Mark. What is happening in this chapter? What is happening? Well, Peter was in prison. So when they went to search for him, he wasn't there. What happened? Well, we know this story because we know that an angel came and led Peter out of the prison. Peter was freed. So when they went in to get him, they could not find him. Now the king was upset and he put the guards to death that were supposed to be watching Peter. Okay? And the scripture says, now, as soon as it was day, there was no small stir among the soldiers. What was become of Peter? There was no small, there was a great uproar, in other words. Everybody was afraid. They were on pins and needles because they knew what this meant. It meant that someone was going to die because Peter could not be found. And when Herod had sought for him and found him not, found who? Not Peter. Peter was gone. He examined the keepers, the guards of the prison, and commanded that they should be put to death because they failed to keep watch over Peter. And Peter had gotten away. And it's what they call stole away in the middle of the night. In the middle of the night, the angel came and led Peter through the prison and out the prison gate. And he went down to Judea of Caesarea and there abode. Who went down there? Peter. went down to Judea of Caesarea, and there he abode, which means he stayed there for a little while. And Herod was highly displeased with them of Tyre and of Sidon. But they came with one accord to him, and having made Blastus, the king's chamberlain, their friend, desired peace. What does that mean? That means that the chamberlain went to the king and said, "Do them no harm, king. They didn't mean anything. Don't do that. You know, they desire peace. Because their country was nourished by the king's country," which meant their supplies, their food and things came from the king. And if the king was upset with them, it meant that they would get no supplies, that there would be a famine. And 21 says that upon a set day, Herod put on his royal attire, and he sat upon his grand throne and made a declaration, a big speech, an oration. An oration is a speech. It goes on and on. He's orating. And the people, afraid of him now, they're afraid, gave a loud shout. They shouted, saying, "It is the voice of a God and not a man." Oh, and Herod loved this so much. They were calling him a God. And he began to eat this up, and he was feeling godly. And what does God do? God sends an angel, and he smote him, because Herod gave not God the glory. So Herod was eaten up then by worms. The people sat there and they saw the worms begin to eat the flesh, all of a sudden coming out of his body, just worms, all consumed by worms. And then he died. He gave up the ghost. Our God is a powerful God who desires praise. When we take it upon ourselves to act like we're greater than God and that we can do things greater, like scientists, oh my, they change everything. They change all kinds of plants. They change, you know, they're trying to change, you know, people who are born, and, you know, your children may have some kind of effects, and they can, you know, wipe out the effect, or you don't have to be worried about that child being born. They can do all of these kinds of things. It's a miracle, you know, these people who talk about they're pro-life, that they don't talk about these scientists who want to kill the baby because the baby might have some kind of effect, birth defect or whatever. Because many times they don't know. They have told parents that the baby wasn't going to come out right, and the parents decided they won't keep the child, and the child was fine. These people are not God. They believe that they are God. They believe they have the technology, the scientific know-how, to be able to tell certain things that they cannot tell. Like today is going to be a sunny day when it be the worst storm of the year. They believe that all this equipment makes them able to do what God on a whim can decide to go in the opposite direction. To forecast things that they have no control over. God is in control of this world. He is in control over us. He is in control over everything that is happening on this planet, in the universe, in the atmosphere, the global changes, the this and the that, the traffic on the road, your neighbor. He's in control of everything. Going into the movie theater, he's in control that nobody will enter in there with a gun and start shooting up the place. Why? Because he's in control. And once he allows the devil a free hand to send somebody in, and you are there. You are there. He's not going to send. That's not going to happen if you are saved and sanctified. Because biblical scripture tells us that it shall not come nigh unto thee. We're talking about all these demonic spirits. These principalities of darkness, these people who are deranged and crazy and acting out under these demonic spirits, who are killing people blindly for no cause. These are spirits, and these spirits are operating in the earthly realm. But the Bible tells us that we are protected by the blood of Jesus. And if you're under the blood of Jesus, and anybody who is near you, they will not be subject to any harm either. Because scripture tells us that we're blessed in the city and blessed in the field. And if you're blessed, your neighbor down the street is blessed. Your street is blessed because you are blessed. That is how God operates. That is how he operates. He's a great God. He's an awesome God. He's wondrous, spectacular in every kind of way. He's God and he's good and he's faithful and merciful to us all. Get into the word of the Lord and study it for yourself. Don't think yourself too big, too great, or too powerful. And certainly never think of yourself greater than God. Because whatever it is that you are doing, as surely as you have risen, he can bring you down or destroy you. He is God. And he desires that we serve him and serve him only and not be self-serving. Until the next time, it is for such a time as this. Bye-bye. We'll see you the next time.
Lord, we honor you, we bless you, we give your name all the praise. Thank you for your goodness, thank you for your kindness. We're overjoyed that you are God in our lives. We have no need to worry about our families or anything else. Because if you be for us, no one can come up against us and win. Lord, I ask you for a fresh anointing. I want to say something to your people that would even touch the heart of a sinner and make him know that he can be saved. I want to see the saints revived, sick folk healed, the captives set free, anybody depressed. I want them to leave this service with smiles on their faces and their heads held high. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray this prayer. Everybody that agreed with the prayer shouted hallelujah and amen. God bless you. You may be seated in the kingdom. Wow, it's good to be here, y'all. Good to be here. I honor my Lord and Savior Jesus. I thank God I'm saved. I'm gonna make this real quick. I don't want to be long at all, but I thank God I'm saved. Let me see the folk that are saved and happy about it. The reason that I'm saved, plain and simple, I love me some Jesus. If that's the reason, and one of the, you know, big reasons that you'll say, just let me see you raise both of your hands. Hold them up there, man. Hold them up there, man. I stretch them to the east and to the west, and whoever you touch, just tell them I'm saved today. I love me some Jesus. Now you need to show somebody that you ain't playing. Thank you, Lord. Amen. We honor the legacy of the great bishop and prophet. And as I looked and walked throughout this building, I can remember being here 20 plus years ago and watching him build this kingdom for the Lord. Amen. The prophet Robert C. Blakes. Come on, clap your hands. Honor the legacy. Are you clapping? Clap for the Son that he left in his place. Bishop Sam. Look, somebody stand on your feet. Praise God. Hallelujah. All right, I'm going to go right into a quick word and pray that it blesses you. We want to read 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17. And then we'll read Romans 8 and verse 18. And we'll move on. If you have 2 Corinthians 4:17, if you would honor God and do me the favor of standing on your feet for the reading of the word. Notice the Bible says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Amen. Romans 8 and verse 18 says, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. And then if I were just daring, I would go down a few more verses and just say at verse 28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Amen. Are you ready to receive what I have for you? Just before you sit down, I want you to grab somebody's hand and shake it like you ain't gonna ever turn it loose. Shake somebody till the eyeballs spin in their head. And say to them while you're shaking them, say, I know you're going through, because I am too. But hear me now, something good is coming out of your struggle. Good is coming out of your struggle. Everybody's struggling with something. A few years ago, I don't know who it was, but they put out a song. Pretty, just wasn't true. Song said, your struggle is over. As a matter of fact, I tried to go with it. Because the song was so pretty. I wanted to go with it. But then the Lord said to me, now, he said that your struggle is over. He said, but I said, man is of a few days and full of trouble. He said the struggle was over, but I said, if you suffer here with me, you will reign with me. Just kind of dig your elbow into somebody's side and tell them, say, you may not appreciate it now, but it won't be long before you're going to see for yourself. something good is coming out of your struggle. In my effort to motivate people all over the country to continue praising God, y'all do know that the only thing that can stop you is if you hush your praise. You have to be determined. I will not hush my praise. Y'all ever seen a mother punishing her little child, little boys in particular? And don't you say nothing else. He's trying to let you know, you ain't gonna stop me from saying what I feel like I need to say. And every day the Lord wakes you up, you need to give the devil a black eye. And say to yourself, this is the day. Which the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Jesus. But you got to trust the Lord. Lean not towards your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. Problem with America. This afternoon, things have become far too complex, hard to separate, hard to analyze and solve. And man can only make matters worse when he tries to fix or do what only God is able to do. But when God is allowed to have his way, things work together for the good to them that love God. The worst of things turn out good. The impossible things, things that are incapable of being or of occurring. The enormously difficult things are all of a sudden moved into the realm of possibility. And when we finally decide that we're going with God's agenda rather than what we had in mind, that's when you're going to see something good come out of your struggle. Thank you, Jesus. Number one, first thing you got to start telling yourself is what Paul said. Paul says, Philippians 4:13, I can do this. Anybody, your back is up against the wall, you're facing something. Now don't lie to me, because everybody in here going through something. I'm even going through something. But you have to tell yourself, I can do this. Shake somebody's hand close to you and tell them, say, I can do this. Through Christ, which strengtheneth me. I dare you to say, yes, I can, yes, I can. Put a little rhythm to it and say, yes, I can. If I want to, yes, I can. Thank you, Jesus. I'm gonna do this. I have times when I got to go on stage, my voice ain't acting right. My legs are hurting.
I don't feel like dancing. Well, see, whatever you don't feel like doing, you find something else and put it in its place. If I get on stage and my legs don't want to dance, and I say, hang on. If my voice don't want to work, and I... Get right in somebody's face and tell them, say, there's always a way for you to praise God. Tell three people, always, always, always. Stand up on your feet and clap your hands. He's been so nice to me until I see his father all in him. Man. But you gotta say, I can. And please understand that it's the way you look at the thing that determines whether or not you can do it. If you look at a situation and prematurely decide that you can't handle it, it ain't gonna work for you. But if you look at it and say, oh yeah, I got this. I can do this. The Lord's going to anoint me to do this. Touch your neighbor and tell them, say, don't forget the anointing, the anointing. A fighter can never win a fight if he doesn't believe he can. If he goes into a fight thinking defeat, he will be defeated. But now watch this. If he goes into a fight believing that he can win, and is yet defeated, people are gonna say, man, he got whooped, but boy, didn't he put up a fight. You know, you gotta go into life's boxing ring knowing that you're gonna get hit. But you gotta believe that while you're gonna get hit, you gotta believe that you gonna throw that final knockout blow. And what God's people need to know, I just wanna have some fun with y'all today. What God's people need to know, I want us to all have mercy, especially some of y'all up there in the balcony. I want you to lose your mind when I tell you to tell your neighbor this. You to know that there's nothing you're into that God can get you out of. Tell somebody on your right and your left, there's nothing you're into God can't get you out of. Something good is coming out of your struggle. Something good is headed your way. The good that's coming is going to be so great until you'll be glad that you were one of them that went through it.
Does save. He saved a wretch like me.
Jesus said.